Welcome to Background Noise. It's a series that I do where I vent about how I'm feeling about the videos that I've done in the past, what I want to do in the future. Now remember, it's like a mini podcast. It's like a little venting process. So don't get the impression that it's a video that you got to watch all the way through. You can listen to it while you're doing your laundry, doing your homework, eating your breakfast. Okay, so it's something you can listen to. Round and round and round I go. Okay, welcome back to Background Noise. I haven't talked personally to the camera since about the summer. I mean, talked personally to the camera as Ethan Wingrove, not as a character, not as Edgar, not as Edison West. That's all I've been doing since the last Background Noise and being late to video games. You know, it's just been characters, which I'm not talking about like I'm unhappy with it, because acting is acting and I like doing that. But I'm just saying, it seems this year, at least, every two videos I've done, it's been a Background Noise. Like, and that's a coincidence, too. I haven't planned this out until just recently. I realized when I planned to film this, I realized, man, the first time this year was with Shoria Lamba. Then I made Ransacking and Being Late to Video Games, and then I made another Background Noise where I told you, you know, how I felt about those videos. And then I made The Office Parody Episode 6. And then after that, I made Locking Horns, which I'm also going to talk about in this video. So yeah, I think it's healthy, you know, to do these so I don't get burnout or I don't get unhappy and anxious with doing videos and keeping up with the expectations of people. Because when I make these, you know how I'm feeling. Okay, I tell you how I'm feeling about my videos, so there is no surprise if I make a change in my content. And you know, it's always great to talk to something about how you're feeling, especially about your role on the internet, even if it's a little role, even if it's just to a camera, because it's not like a lot of people I know do YouTube. It's not like a lot of people I know I can talk about the grind of promoting and working on a video and how that has an effect on me to other people who can actually relate to it. They'll understand it, but nobody except Shoria Lamba, you know, I can talk to personally, will really, really get it. And that's okay, okay? I'm not kind of frustrated that everyone I know does TikTok. That's fine. Wow, that is not going to age well. I don't think any of these are going to age well because it's a very specific time in my life I'm making all of these. They're all kind of like snapshots of how I'm feeling at the time. But everyone around me, it's like every single day I find out someone else I thought I knew has a TikTok account. And every time I'm like, oh, you too. They got you too. And it's not even the fact that TikTok is seen as cringy or something like that. There's just things on TikTok, like there's sketch comedy on TikTok, you know, and there's different types of comedic and or serious things on TikTok, some musical things. Why not just put those on YouTube, man? Okay, you're making good content in a vertical format, and you're forced to make it in a vertical format, as far as I'm concerned. It's not like I use the app, but just put it on YouTube. Maybe it's also popular because it has its own communities and trends, and it helps you. It gives you the tools to add effects to your videos without having to download another editing software and watch the tutorials on that. It gives you a bunch of free, easy-to-use effects. As far as I'm concerned, it's not like I use it. You know, last time I really put the time in to watch a lot of TikToks was when I made a video about a year ago criticizing someone's TikToks. Okay, so it's not a social media thing that I go on regularly. You know what? You want to know what I do go on regularly? YouTube. And I feel like that whole segment right there, I wasn't talking like, I felt like I was kind of putting on a over energetic facade right there. Certain things I said, I don't know. I know me better than you know me, but yeah, I just want to talk honestly about, let's start with The Office Parody Episode 6. So we had a new cast member in it. And I am super glad I made that. I had that idea like in 2018, but then Christmas came around. I had to make a Christmas special, 'cause how do you not make a Christmas special when you're making a sitcom series, okay? You gotta have the holiday specials if you wanted to be like Friends in the Office. I'm not saying I'm trying to, have the same notoriety as Friends in the Office with the Office parody. But you gotta have, themed stuff on there. I've been wanting to call it Ethan Wingrove's The Office for a long time, but I can't just change the thumbnails and stuff like that. It's called The Office Parody, and I can't change it. Okay, so Locking Horns is very different from Ransacking. I thought it was gonna be, no, when I had the vision of Locking Horns before I started making it, I thought it was gonna be in the same category of as Ransacking. Not in quality, because I don't really like to compare them. They're pretty different, but just in the same category of style. But they are very different, and I didn't even know that until a week after I finished making the thumbnail and I finished publishing it. The thumbnails for them are similar, and the credits and end credit styles are kind of similar, but they're very different tones, and they're about very different things. Okay, Ransacking was more comedic. It had a lot more comedic elements. And in Locking Horns, it's called Locking Horns because everyone is always arguing, and there's so much animosity between everyone. Everybody has like a chip on their shoulder for some reason because of another character, and at the end that gets like to a boiling point. I don't want to spoil it. If you haven't seen it, go watch it, but that's why I wanted it to be such a sudden shift between I wanted it to be a sudden shift between everyone arguing and everyone having a slight chip on their shoulder and being passive aggressive towards everyone to like a nice calm commercial. With nice music. No music during the scenes, everyone talking about, dude, just give me the job. No, I didn't pick you too high. I'm Edison West. And blah 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 blah. Artificial advertisement stuff. That was the point. And I think I executed that pretty well. It was inspired by Once Upon a Time in Hollywood. I don't know if I said it before, but every short film I've made, at least recently, I've gotten the idea from something else that I've watched, or a bunch of things that I've watched. It sounds like I steal a lot of things. Like I watch something and I'm like, oh, I like that idea, I'm gonna use that. But that's not what it is. I don't understand if you can come up with an original idea without seeing any other media or any other stories to take inspiration from. If you can, you're probably like a genius, or maybe I'm like an insane person. But all of my ideas have been like a combination of different aspects I've liked of other videos and movies I've seen, maybe even subconsciously, maybe even without even noticing it now, I've put some details in there that I liked from other stuff. Now, Locking Horns was, I can't say that I worked the hardest I've ever worked on something, like a video on it, overall, because I also worked the hardest I've ever worked on a video for Ransacking, but I can't say overall. Here's where the difference is. Let's start with Locking Horns because I made it the most recently, and I want these videos to be talking about something I made recently, You enjoying the video, the audio? Comment. No, don't comment down below like what are you doing or you're listening to it. That's so stupid. Are you doing, dude, comment if you're wearing your socks while doing laundry while listening to this. Anyway, Locking Horns, I did the most work on the organization. I spent the most time setting up all the props and equipment for the filming process, and I spent the most time taking them all down. And that's all because I had more production value to work with. Ransacking, I spent more time causing physical harm to myself. I'm not, it's not, it wasn't Apocalypse Now. It wasn't The Revenant. I wasn't in Ontario getting like frostbite filming these. But I was out in the snow in Ransacking and my fingers were going numb. And I was filming until I couldn't stand anymore during dialogue scenes, you know? But all I had was a camera, and I was filming with the internal mic of the camera in ransacking. In locking horns, I have an external microphone on a boom pole. And in the one inside shot of the entire movie, I had a real light. Like, not like a random little studio light like I'm using right now. It's small and convertible, but like a big light that I had to set up and I had to screw in the light bulbs into. The production value on Lock and Horns was much better than ransacking. I'm going to give it that. The sound quality of the talking and ransacking is in Lock and Horns is way better than ransacking. And the only way, what's tricky about it, the tricky thing about it is the only way you'll really notice good dialogue sound design is if you don't notice it. It's like a user interface. The best way is to enjoy it is when it's not noticeably bad and it's unnoticeably good. Because if there is not a lot of background noise and the voices sound crisp and easy to understand and you're not finding yourself, you know, having trouble hearing what they're saying, that's good sound quality. If there's trucks and stuff moving in the background, you know, that might be a little bit of a fault on sound editing. And I'm not saying I'm the best sound editor in the world. Maybe there was some of that in Lock and Horns. Go check. Give me more watch time. Go check. Give me more feedback so I can improve. Please. But that's the thing. I think I'm gonna give Lock and Horns the credit for that because the sound quality was way better on that. And it kind of went unnoticed. It kind of went unnoticed in a good way. So I'm very, very happy with that. I think the biggest thing I'm unhappy about in Locking Horns is that it's short. You know? Wow, I really just like leaned pretty far in with my right shoulder in there. I'm just trying to rest my elbow. This is a heavy microphone and I'm very weak. I know it's not a surprise. I feel like I should get closer to the microphone. I'm not doing any ASMR, but I feel like I should get closer to the microphone. Wow, it's been 15 minutes, and I got so much more I want to talk about. I'm going to go until my SD card runs out. I don't even care. Probably not, because it's 16 gigs, but, you know, we'll see. We'll see what's up. What was I even talking about? Oh, yeah! Yeah! So, Locking Horns is shorter than ransacking, okay? I did not intend it to be shorter. I did not intend ransacking to be long. Wow, I'm name dropping ransacking a lot in this. There is no intention to have any length in particular when making any sort of video I've ever made. I write it out, I film it, I edit it, and it happened to be 9 minutes. You know? I didn't leave anything on the cutting room floor. You know, for pacing issues. So I'm glad about that. I didn't have to cut anything out. And I put everything in there that I wanted to. I had everything that I wrote in there. I got done. And I put it in there. Oh, except for the end credits scene. But the audio got corrupted on that. We're not going to talk about that. We're not going to talk about the end credits scene. Not important. It's just a little tidbit. It's just like a throwaway scene. I guess what could have been done to make Locking Horns longer, not artificially longer just to pad the runtime for no reason, but to add more meat to the story. You know, maybe I could have been maybe I could have shown the audition. No, I don't want to show the audition, but because that's kind of the whole point. But maybe I could have fleshed out the characters more and had their backstories and shown more of the film set and shown more of the filmmaking process. But none of that came to me in the writing of the movie. I never thought, you know what, I'm feeling lazy right now. I don't want to give the backstory of these guys. I just never thought about it. I just said, this is what's going to happen in the story. These are the beats I want to follow. This is what's going to happen. Boom. Done. Finito. I don't even know if that's a word. Yeah, the whole thing I was saying why I didn't want to show the audition is because there's a big anticipation. I'm going to switch hands. This is getting tiring. But there's a big anticipation built up, maybe not a big one, maybe not, you know, to you, But there's supposed to be a little anticipation built up of meeting the director and the audition at the bus stop scene. And that's the opening scene after the credits. So like, okay, I'm going to meet the director, you know, and it's kind of a little subtle flex. I'm going to meet the director in private. Well, it was on the call sheet. I'm going to meet the director. And my character, I end off the conversation with saying, let's just focus on meeting this director. And then J cut to the director talking to me after I got the part. So it's supposed to be like a, wait, what? He got the part. Wow. That's crazy. Maybe you didn't have that reaction, you know? But best case scenario, somebody's jumping off their couch, running around the house. Ooh, Edison got the part. Damn. Yeah, what? Whatever. But it's supposed to be like a, let's just see how this goes. And then boom. Hey, you got the part. How's it going? And it's supposed to be like, whoa. Whoa, that's kind of crazy. That's a little sudden twist right there. Skip that audition. Boom, he got the part. Let's move on with the story. I had a lot of flashbacks in it. And wow. Hold on. Okay, I'm going to talk about it after. But I had a lot of flashbacks in it. Now, artsy movies, very artsy movies, don't even tell you it's a flashback. They don't show any black and white. They don't show any sepia or sepia or sauna. You know what I'm talking about? That yellowish font in there to show it's in the past. They don't do any of that. It's a cut, and then boom, you're in the past. You should know what's going on. We're not treating you like you're an idiot. You should be smart, audience. That's kind of what I did, just because I felt like it worked. There was no need to imitate artsy big movies because, you know, I really want to be like them. I was just like, okay, I think it just works. I don't want to put any text on screen like, after the audition, you know, at least in, Ransacking, I put some black bars up and down, but I think it would just feel wrong, at least in those short films, if there was text on screen saying the place, time, and date. You know? Office parody, that's fine. 2018, 2019 markers, that's okay. But Locking Horns, Ransacking, that's a no-no. You know? Any of my other feature short films, that's a no-no. At least now. Somebody, goes by Just Joe. That's his YouTube profile name. Him or her. I don't know. It's just their username. Just Joe. Okay? Now this person commented, the entire screenplay in the comments of Locking Horns with never seeing the script to it, just watching it, copying everything down, and putting parentheses like, where in chronological order we are in the story, which is crazy. Shout out to Just Joe. You're probably not listening to this, but you know, shout out to Just Joe for real for doing that. That video only has auto-generated captions. I've never put closed captions on a video that I've manually typed out myself, just because it's never crossed my mind. But anybody that's like, headphones are broken or whatever, you can follow along in the comments. You just scroll down and like, oh yeah, yeah, especially if you're on mobile, you can see the video while you're scrolling down. PC users, I'm sorry. But, anywho, I saw the comment and he just commented the opening monologue. In my eyes, that's what I saw. I was like, oh, okay. He commented the opening monologue. Cool. Awesome. Went down a little further. Oh, now we're at this part. Now we're at the end? Are you kidding me? That is crazy. Okay, now I want to talk about, wow, this is a long video. This is almost as long as another short film I made this year. I want to talk about my future ideas for a video, okay? If you want me in a short film to quench your comedy element thirst, I got you, but not right now, okay? I have an idea for a Guy Ritchie-inspired armed robbery short film called Theft Quartet. Because there's four robbers in there. That's copyrighted by Ethan Wingrove. If you take Theft Quartet, I'm gonna not be happy. I'm not gonna be happy about it, okay? Seriously, Theft Quartet is a dope name, at least by my standards. And legally, every heist film needs to have a driver. I'm not gonna have the criminals take the bus after the armed robbery, although I had that idea, but I need a driver in it so I can have some cool shots of driving. I only know one person that can legally drive, you know, alone for me to film, and that's my brother, okay? He was in Ransacking, he's not in Lock and Horns, he is in The Office Parodies, and he's got his own YouTube channel, which he's back to uploading. You know, I'll link it in the description, why not? The Graphic Loop, go check him out. But, he's got a job, so he can't film. I was gonna make Theft Quartet in the summer, and he's like, I can't film, I'm making money, which is fine. I'm not mad at him for that, but I was like, okay, I gotta push it to the side. I gotta come up with a new concept. I spent an entire Tuesday night sitting down. I refused to hang out with Shoria Lamba, my good friend who also does YouTube and is in my videos. Go check him out. Like in the description, I refused to hang out with him because I was sitting in this room under the Skylanders poster right there in a little chair, hunched back, just angry because I couldn't come up with an idea. I was thinking of all these scenarios and like what ifs premises, and I was just sitting there and I was like, dude, these ideas suck. These ideas suck. I'm not happy with any of these. I was supposed to do a video in August. This sucks. Went and took a shower, and then I came up with the idea. Boom. Inspired by Once Upon a Time in Hollywood. I saw the movie earlier that summer, and I was like, that's the next video, man. And Lock and Horns isn't a substitute. It's not a B-side idea that I was like, I'll just throw that in there because I have to make a video. I was like, okay, the shower thoughts starting coming in, and I'm like, okay, this video is awesome. So I have the heist film brewing a little bit. I want to make a black and white Twilight Zone inspired short film because I got a cool filter on my camera that I want to make use of. Not just because of that, also because 2019 Twilight Zone, saw two episodes of it. Those two episodes were pretty cool. I don't know about the rest of the show because I haven't seen it, but those two first episodes, they were pretty cool. I want to make something inspired by that. I want to make like a crazy psychological thriller type thing, like what's real, what's not. Maybe that's not even the concept. Maybe it's aliens. You don't know, because I just thought of it this week. Just thought of it on Monday. I'll admit it. And in the winter, I got something big going. Red Snow. I'm not going to make snow that's red. It's a short film called Red Snow, and it's a horror short film. It's a horror movie that takes place in the dead of winter, in the snow, man. And it's going to be awesome. I got the soundtrack picked out for this thing, okay? I got the story beats, I got the look, I got the title, and I got the freaking soundtrack picked out for this thing. That's how passionate I am about Red Snow right now. I wanted to make that last year, couldn't do it, didn't snow in time. But don't get it twisted, I'm not more motivated about this thing than I am about the Twilight Zone and the Guy Ritchie-inspired heist film, because they're all at the equal level of motivation. No project is going in front of the other, okay? I want to make another video where I'm talking to the camera about something that I care about, but I'm not going to clown on any more YouTubers unless they come after me first. Unless I gotta defend myself, I'll do it. But I'm not gonna find an account that I don't like and just say, this account sucks for no reason. Okay? I wanna make more videos like being late to video games, which, by the way, was such a good video. Go watch it. Link in the description. I talk about that in the last background noise. You haven't seen it? Go watch it. You haven't seen Lock and Horns? Go watch it. You haven't seen Ransacking? Go watch it. You haven't seen any other video that I've made? Go watch them.